there.
I apologize for the stupidity here, well, in this area.
You have some things to say about that. I want to hear about that, too. I think this is the first time you've had any handcuffs for an interview.
No. 2 or 3 times. So, how am I doing?
Chip.
Close the door. The door.
So I've always accepted Paramount as being one of the higher sleazy networks. I was surprised at your show and disappointed, actually.
You're talking about the hard drop ad.
On your show? I mean, you know, your network has always been with quality and abilities that are outstanding in the field.
What was the objection? What were some of your objections?
Well, you come off, you imply things that are unproven. You come off just to make entertainment rather than report what really is in fact. What is in fact is that the people around me wanted me to be what you called rock and roll singer. I wasn't even thinking of anything like that, you know. I do what I do. I ride a motorcycle and I play a guitar. And my road is mine. I keep a gun in my boot and a knife in my pocket, and I do what I want. I'm free, pretty much. And people come around me, and they like my music, and they say, why don't you do this, this, and that, and so forth. Doris Day's son comes to me with the offer, and I say, okay, sounds good. Then he sends me the Oriental hatchet from the Korean War that Doris Day has been laboring with. That has nothing to do with the road I'm on. I walk with General MacArthur and my grandfather in the First World War. Am I communicating to you?
Yes.
So he's coming from his mother's insecurity, and he was raised up by a maid rather than his mother. I'm with 50 cutthroats who ride motorcycles, who kill people, who are bad and no good at all.
But you're saying that Terry Melcher misrepresented to you your possibilities as a singer and made false promises to you?
I wasn't in trade to be anything. I was what I am. I'm not trying to labor into someone else's opinion of what they think of me. I care less what other people think of me. I care what I think of me.
Did you have people come to you and tell you that you had promise as a singer?
Promise as what? To offer into where? I don't offer myself into lops who are lopsided in their brains. I'm the king, man. Do you understand that? I walk on my own road. I don't need nobody's existence. I got my own trip, even though I'm handcuffed in it right now, which doesn't look too cool. Thank you, folks. But what I'm trying to explain to you, if you'll let me, is that when you give your word to somebody in the underworld, as Milcher did, and there's people around me that are in the same color that I'm in, that are riding in the same bike that I'm riding on. When he gave his word to me, he gave this word to them. When he fronted me off and I had to fight 2 or 3 people in behind the barn, then that fell off onto the people that were around me, and they picked it up and took it to him. I didn't have anything to do with it. I was somewhere else doing another trip.
Did these people around you that you're talking about know that Melcher was living in Sharon Tate's?
Sure they do. Sure they do. That's my neighborhood. I live in Pacific Palisades. That's been my neighborhood since a long time. I'm the Beverly Hillbilly. You ever hear of a Beverly Hillbilly? Well, that's me.
I want to hear a little bit.
Beverly Hills, Kentucky. They have a Beverly Hills, Kentucky.
I want to hear more about the handcuffs and so forth, if you could. We need to just pop the tapes up, make sure they're okay, and change the tapes. We're just going to give you just 2 minutes to do that. And she's going to take them out, check them out. You've been in Portland how long?
As long as forever is, man. I don't live in time yet. I'm just here.
Shipping the same side.
Wait.
your hand.
Yeah, so when you put it in this place.
I have opinions, but opinions don't change much.
What is this one right here?
Yeah, I have opinions about insecurity.
I got a sign cut in.
Put it right outside.
They're just taking that tape to check and make sure the sound's okay, vision quality.
And the other one is Jen's hand?
Yes.
Technology, by tip.
Should you have a problem?
Yeah.
So we brought two cameras, one was bound to work.
No, it's not the camera, it's just the, it's okay.
Is there a...
Are you getting two or something?
Yeah.
$229. You need to get this one in here.
So where's the other young fellow that was working with you before?
The cameraman?
Yeah.
He works at CBS now.
Yeah.
You know, the interviewer, Bill Stout, he died.
Yeah.
Yeah, did you hear about that?
He was a pretty nice fellow, rather dull, man. He wasn't very deep in his...
Well, you were very entertaining.
He was kind of superficial in his world.
Heard him call a lot of criminals.
Well, I mean, you've seen him from a personal view. I'm talking about professionally.
Yeah,
professionally, he was a pretty well opinionated. He had his mind pretty well made up, man. He was stuck in 1950, about 1955. His brain was done.
That's when he started. That's when he was his first.
Yeah.
You okay, Chip?
Yep.
Okay.
It's difficult for you people to stay up with the minds of the people that are controlling your minds. That's another thing that I would like to chastise you for.
We're on, so go ahead.
You know, you say I control the minds. How am I convicted as being your father? Your father's the one who controls the minds, and how can I control a mind any more than my mind has been controlled? What is the mind? You come into the words, you use the words of English to say what the mind is, but then you don't even know what the mind is. You think you have a mind? There's no such thing as I have a mind. The mind belongs to God. God is the mind. But yet, you come up to me and say that I control the minds of your children. And I've only been back in this country for a couple of years. I've been in Mexico. I've been in Spain. I've been everywhere in the world fighting bulls and doing other things. I wasn't even thinking about the acid world.
But you're aware that in the parole hearings that Principal Atkins and Houghton Watson have all said, Charles Manson, through the use of LSD, controlled my mind and made me do the things that I did.
Okay. That's
you're
what they
aware
said.
They're saying that.
No.
They've said that at many occasions. At the
they have. I haven't heard it.
And
if they have, I haven't heard it.
That's been their continual statement, that drugs, Charles Manson used drugs to control me, and he sent me for...
All right, we'll just show you how silly that is. Anybody that knows anything about drugs, the only way drugs control your mind is they'll control your mind until you can get it. And then when you get it, then you're gone. You take the drugs and leave. No, LSD doesn't control anyone's mind. It may actually work in the opposite. It may uncontrol your mind. But control your mind for what? Control your mind for where? It's all explainable. It all could have been explained. But Vincent Bugliosi is a Roman Catholic. And Stovitz is a Jew from Poland. That's why they have a Polish Pope now. It's because they didn't want the truth to come out. They wanted to sell this helter-skelter off into the public's mind. So they could sell and buy this game that you're playing now, which is insanity.
What about Helter Skelter and the Beatles?
You've got another war. That's insanity. That just come up from somebody else's imagination. It had nothing to do with me. It come back like this. It can be explained, but you can't explain it in a half-hour show. You know, there is so much, and it's so vast, and it's so awesome. It's so much. Right now, you're in a holy war. I told you 20 years ago I had the oil and gas in the desert. I told you 20 years ago, get back to the horse. I told you your atmosphere is dying, man.
Did you predict what's going on right now?
Right, just a second. It does not predict. A blind Indian could look down the road and see that the dust is on the road. You know, you see the foot tracks going down the road, you say, hey, man, you're going off in the plastic on front of a battle of phenomenon instead of a battle. I mean, you've got a problem, you've got a brain, man. It's a little distance to every room, but I'm on another level of thought. When you've got brains, man, you can understand what the hell is going on in the world now, and you can see what's going to turn to. It's going to turn to, oil's got to stop. Or you're all going to die. You're running out of air. We're running out of atmosphere. General Motors and Toyota don't want to accept that the atmosphere is dying and you're not going to have any breath left if you don't stop those automobiles. In other words, there's so much to it.
Well, let's take your opinions on one man, Saddam Hussein.
I am that.
You are Saddam Hussein.
I was Charlie on the whole Men Shin Trail.
Your sympathies lie with Saddam Hussein or with Jordan?
My sympathies lie with me, with the truth, with God. You heard of Charlie on the whole Men Shin Trail? Mm-hmm. Well, you remember the movie Wild Wild West? You remember the train that guy played in that movie? Go over and ask that guy how long he's been play acting me. I just didn't come on the set. I already broke through the stars in Indiana in 1940, or back in the 40s, a long time ago. A long time ago. I've already been through this a million times.
They tell me that inside here you still are getting a lot of mail, and a lot of people are
saying, I'm alive.
What you have to say.
I am alive. You people have some idea that just because you're locked up in jail that you're dead. There's a whole back world out there. There's crow gods and there's lizards. I've got a whole desert out there running, doing all kinds of things that you're not even aware of.
Does it please you that a lot of people write to you still?
Please. I have no please or displease or pleasure or displeasure. I balance it in the wisdom of all things, man. I'm not in trade for buy and sell. I'm not in that same thought that you live in.
Do you write back to any of these people?
I write back to everyone I get a chance to.
And what kind of message do you give them?
Agua.
Which is?
Air, water, trees, and wildlife.
An environmental message of sorts.
And life. God. God is life. God is the sun. God is all life and the moon. And the balance of all earth is air that we breathe. First, order. Water that we drink, second, we need. Trees that give us both, that you're cutting down 4 billion trees a day and nobody cares. You don't even care for the children. How are you gonna stop this war? You won't even let your children out to stop the last one. The children that are busted that you blame me for are your children. When are you gonna start taking responsibility for your own children? You wanna blame me for what they did? For mind control? Kind of stupid, actually. Maybe I influenced. And it's possible that some of those people still might not understand the whole picture of what I'm saying. People were impressed by my music. They liked my music and they wanted to follow that music. They followed that music and they did what they did. It's not my responsibility what they do. I walked with them. I told Patty. When Patty said she was going to do what she did, I said, take these glasses, woman. Come here. And she came over and I said, take those glasses. I said, if you've made up your mind to do this, and this is what you want to do, are you prepared to face this? And she said, yes. I said, well then, drop those glasses off on the floor, wherever you go, and leave something witchy for me, will you? In the underworld, I am not obligated to stop anyone from committing a crime, because crime to me is not by the same definition as crime to you. What may be a crime to you, I would take advantage of in the darkness and the shadows of that light and order into the perfection of my world, the road I live on.
But back to Patricia Kremlin, are you saying that she got the idea to do those murders herself without any suggestion?
She got the ideas from a circle of people. A circle of people called red, blue, gold, and yellow. Those circles are set in what's called the rainbow. And Squeaky Fromm is red. She gave her life to this country for the rights of the common people. She's doing life in prison. Nobody cares about it. They don't even look at it. They just turn their back on her because they can't face her. They claim her, they pick her apart, they destroy her in a thousand ways. You know how the world is. And then there's Blue. She just got out of prison. She just flew from the east to the west.
Sandra.
Then there's Gold, which is Nancy. There's Yellow, which is Patty. I can't believe Patty would say I had... Patty don't lie. I've known Patty for 21 years and I've never known her to lie about anything. It's not in Patty to lie. Patty is an honest person. She's a straight-up woman. In fact, she's a very powerful woman. She's a good woman. And I have a lot of respect for her.
Are you still in touch with her?
Yeah. I'm still in touch with all of them.
And what do you say to someone like Patricia Kremlin?
I would say, she knows what I would say. I am her. She is me. We are one. We're all together. It's always been that way. I mean, whatever you say yourself is what I would say to you.
Do you think that Patricia Crumley, Cole Weston, Van Houten, Susan Atkins ought to be paroled?
I think they should not only be paroled, but I think you should do exactly as they tell you to do and get in their will, because they're the rainbow people.
The parole boards say there's a
bunch of stupid bureaucrats, man, who are laying up on the dollar bill, dripping gold markets and playing Chinese politics with Nixon. Nixon's already sold this country out 3 times. The country's already gone. We're sitting in the Bank of Hong Kong somewhere. I heard Japan just bought your studio. Is that right?
Not ours, but most of them.
Yeah. In other words, along with your money goes the knife that's protecting your money. And who's protecting your money? I was the only one protecting your money. Nixon wasn't protecting your money. I was protecting your money, because who was going to fight for her? Me and Bill, we would fight for her, but who else would fight for her? Nobody going to fight for her. They're ripping her off in the alley and it's dark. Who's going to go back there and help her? Nobody. But stupid people like me. That's why I end up in this mess. Because your children came to me. I didn't come to them. They come to me weak without a father. They come to me weak without truth. And they ask me, can I stay with you? I got no place to stay. I said, well, I ain't got no place to stay either. I'm a child also. Well, where's my parents, you know? My father died in the war, so my father's the war. And we're locked in the war. So I put the war on my forehead and I say, look, let's stop the war. If we don't stop the war, we're all going to be dead. It's going to kill us all. We can't afford this, man. And is there any intelligence among you? So if we stop the war, we'll lose the economy. You're going to lose the economy anyway. Get yourself a hoe and start growing some corn. Get you some chickens. Get back on the ground with it, man. Get your horse. Get in behind the wagon wheels and start all over again. If you don't, there's going to be nothing left.
Now, let's say you were paroled. Would you work on these environmental things that you talked
about? That's what I was doing when I was arrested.
Because some people I've talked to, guards at other institutions, have said that you've told them that you would just go out to Death Valley and become a hermit.
Sometimes. Here, that's where I was at before. See, here's the thing. Why are we doing this? What is our reason for this? Something to do. When you've got all the money in the world, why do you do anything? I'm not working for money. And they said, well, you're working for women. I've got all the women in the world. I've got 35 old ladies. What am I going to work for women for? They're cooking for me, man. I just sit around and play music. Music is my world. I just play music. I play music and I was planting trees. I was into putting trees out. I put a whole bunch of trees out in the desert. Fake trees. Trees was my life. I love trees. I like animals, you know. People, I don't get along too well with people. But animals, I like animals. I like animals. I like horses. And I like people. A little bit, not much, a few people. But I'm a pretty lugubrious old man, actually. Once I was a different kind of person, but that isn't what I am. Really hasn't got anything to do with what it is.
But you're saying you have changed?
Changed. I change from every minute. Change constantly. I'm in constant change. See, you don't understand my mind, man. You know, you going to school, you had a mother and father. I went to school, I had no mother and father. You were raised up in a society full of rules and regulations. I was raised up in a penitentiary playing handball and ducking knives, man.
There's a story that you didn't want to be released from terminal island.
Well, I want. See, that's another thing. To be free in your soul as a man, you got to be free from want. I don't really want anything. I make myself hard. You don't give me a hard on. My dick gets hard by myself. I don't want. It's there.
But if they
paroled, it's in the soul.
If they paroled you from here, you're aware of the case of Lawrence Singleton, the rapist who cut off the woman's arms, and he went from community to community, and people demonstrated, and they couldn't find any place to parole him. Are you not afraid if you were released from here that you'd be shot dead the minute you walked out those front gates?
Shot dead by who? Who you got to shoot anyone? Ain't got nobody on your side that can shoot anybody, man. Is she gonna shoot me? She's walking in me now. That's mine. She's only standing, you're standing in her. She's already mine. I took her a long time ago. I grabbed her and took her out of the parking lot. We went down the road, I took her off. To Bonnie and Clyde, we died in Ma Barker's cabin over there on the dark side. You guys have been real. Humphrey Bogart was not the one you've seen in the movies. The real James Cagney, it's not the one you see. Those were the actors. There's a difference between Selleck and me. Selleck plays Magnum PI. I am Magnum PI. There's the helicopter pilot over there. That's the ghost of Terminal Island, in the truth. He's the ghost of the man. The other guy's an actor. Guys are only play acting, shadows of. Right now, you're ready to pick up another actor and play this, what is going to make another movie called, what is that movie they're going to make with Sean Penn, with that doobie dad from Long Beach, comes along with Red Crack, that's bad.
Well, the thing is still, I want to show you something, maybe you've seen it, maybe you haven't seen it. Okay, this is a Star newspaper. A recent Star newspaper.
Is this where your mind is?
No, this. I just want to get your reaction to it because you never have a chance to respond to this stuff. It comes out all the time. And they're saying that you were actually after Candace Bergen because she was Terry Melcher's girlfriend.
Who's Candace Bergen?
Murphy Brown.
Murphy Brown, Candace Bergen.
I mean, I'm giving you a chance to respond. How often do you get a chance to respond to this? Is the first time you've seen this?
Yeah, I don't.
This is just last week. How does that make you feel?
I know where it's coming from. It's coming from Buckingham Palace, Gate 12. Because Gate 10 just got blown up for coming out with the one before that.
I can't tell whether this makes you laugh or whether this makes you angry or whether you don't care.
What difference does it make? You sold public opinion so much that it doesn't mean anything anyway. What's public opinion? You buy and sell it. What's it worth? Nothing.
Is it true?
True. True about what?
Is what they're printing here true? Is it true that you were after Ginsburg?
I'm not after. Why would I be after anyone? Is that a waste of time? I don't have enough time to be after somebody. If I had to be after everybody that wanted me to be after them, man, I got a list a mile long. Last time I did with the, what was that name, that guy named Geraldo Rivera?
Yeah.
He had to go out and say, I was after him too. I'm after everyone. How could I be after everybody? So many, you know, I just couldn't, you know, it's impossible.
You weren't trying to kill Geraldo Rivera?
No. For what? For what?
I don't know.
I couldn't think of any reason. Maybe he's got a killing coming. He wants someone to kill him. Maybe he's begging, he's praying for God to kill him. I don't know. A lot of people are stuck in death wish, you know. But that hasn't got anything to do with me.
But you haven't done anything against Robert?
I haven't, man, not for or against. I ain't got no chest.
Murphy Brown.
Who in the hell is Murphy Brown, man?
Candace Bergen.
I don't even know who Candace Bergen is. That's how dumb I am. I'm really dumb. You wouldn't believe how stupid I am. I'm a hillbilly.
How close?
I burned the school down when I was 9.
How close do you follow what's going on out there in TV and music?
I live on another level, man. I live on another level, way far away from you guys. You live on a...
You got a parole hearing coming up.
I did.
In the past, you haven't always taken those too seriously. How do you look toward this one? Are you going to make a serious attempt to present them with the idea that you could get out and then you are rehabilitated and save change?
Rehabilitated.
Are you rehabilitated?
No, I don't think I'm rehabilitated. I don't think I'm rehabilitated.
They're going to ask you at these hearings, I'm sure you're well more aware than I am.
What?
Do you have remorse?
Remorse or what? If they say you admit that you're wrong and that we're right, and you submit to us, and what we say is being true and all that, and we'll go back to Socrates and we'll give him a little poison, and we'll say, here, Socrates, we got the same problem we had all the way back when you was first put in the first cell. Take the poison and die in that cell, or say you're full of shit and we'll let you go. You know, so the parole board wants me to go in and kowtow to their reality and say that their reality is the real reality and my reality is really the stupid, dumb reality. I give my reality to the uniform. And the uniform, when the man declared a holy war, all the uniforms of the world come to attention in God. Even though you ding-dongs who don't believe in God, it doesn't matter. The uniforms still ring all through this country, all through the world. Now, we in the uniform don't need civilization in your society. We can do without your inquirer and your lies and your fakes and your phonies. Because in the military, you have to be right or they'll put you against the wall and shoot you.
Have you given up on that parole hearing even before it's already?
I haven't given up on anything. I'll take anything that goes. You unhandcuff me now. We'll go wherever you want to go. You unlock my door any time of night, anytime you want to. I've always been there. It doesn't matter.
Let me ask you about the prison regime here. kept by yourself, how does it work? Where do you eat? Where do you exercise? What freedoms do you have? Freedom's probably the wrong word to use.
I don't have any freedom.
What is your
freedom? I don't have any freedom. I'm on 4-point restraint. I'm strapped down to a bed. I'm locked up completely in everybody else's insecurities. And the stuff that you say about me on the TV the other day, it falls right on me, and I got to carry it.
The reputation.
All the insanity that you put forth, that is untrue. It's not even documented in court.
The publicity causes you problems inside the institution.
Because most of the people that run these places watch you people.
And what attitude do they have toward you?
They have the attitude that you project through your cameras. That's the reason I'm here, trying to clean that up a little bit.
And that comes down hard on you inside
the institution? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Because I'm carrying you on my back. I'm carrying her. I'm carrying the set. I'm carrying the set with my ghost. That's my ghost there. That's my ghost there.
Is your problem with the prison staff or with other inmates?
My problem is with stupidity, insecurity, in the name of security. People who are afraid won't face themselves.
Some inmate tried to kill you.
Oh, come on, man.
Did he?
What do you mean? Kill me for what?
Tried to burn you.
Oh, so he did burn me. He gave me a suntan, okay? He baptized me in a Christian Venta church or whatever. That's up to me and him. It's got nothing to do with nobody but me and him.
And he wasn't trying to kill you?
Kill me. If he tried to kill me, I'd have been dead. He killed his own father. He blew his father's brains out with a shotgun in Pasadena.
Do you fear for your life inside here?
I was his father. I came back to life. He didn't like it.
What about your feelings about your personal safety inside here?
I don't have any personal feelings.
You don't have any fears about your personal
safety? I don't have any personal. I'm the number of just a B-33-920. My personal's hanging on the ventilators in the nut boards.
They let you have a TV set in here or watch TV?
If I wanted one, yeah, but I'm you know, TV's really a downer, man. You've got a beautiful media, and you're destroying it. You're destroying the world with that insanity.
You talk a lot about the music, and I want to ask you about that. Do you still compose music? Do you still play music?
I don't compose or play music. I sing music. Music is my... In reform school, we used to go back and hold. Well, that's a heart, man. Put your guitar roll on. Say, what? Is that right? Yeah. Okay. Bring your guitar on, man. Tell it, you get down off that motherfucker. Run. Someone right, you know. Head on that sound. Yeah, that's the way we do it. That's the way I do it. That's the way the chain gang does it. That's the way I was raised up doing it.
That's your music today.
My music is the sound of men in prison. My music is the tear in Leavenworth, Kansas. It's Bill saying, give me a shot of that coffee, boy. How'd you get that out of here? Sound around your song, that song. Practicati. Go on, say, man. It's no long, no change.
Since you've been in here, we've got some of the headlines. Yeah, well, some of the headlines of music people.
Well, let me finish.
Since you've been here, no, go ahead on.
Yeah,
I'm just curious.
Let me finish.
Lennon died while you were in here. Elvis died.
Yeah.
While you were all while you were in.
Let me get back to this other one before you go through change.
Because I want to hear.
They got a woman that stands in the court of the English court. She holds the black buttons on her white dress. That woman with the black buttons on her white dress is in trouble. England is in trouble. English economy is in trouble. They want me to go back to England and live in a bottle of Scotch whiskey and be the numbers in the Bank of London because I know the economy and I know how the money rolls. I've been rolling nickels out the back door all my life. But I won't do that because I'm helping somebody else. That's a friend of mine whose water is dying, whose fish can't even live in the lakes, and all this creation that we do in the United States, we see a acid rain from Canada. But if you lived in Mexico and seen acid rain from Estados Unidos, you'd see that we're killing the world with this society that we got going. If we don't stop this pollution, we're not only going to murder everybody in the United States of America. You're all in the gas chamber. You're going to destroy everybody in Latin America also. You're cutting down the trees so fast that we can't even keep up with it. You're polluting the water so quick. with your soap and your toothpaste and your shaving lotion and your after-bath with creams and your boogie blonde damn black locks, and you won't change your reality, man. You won't even look at another reality. You keep blaming it off on me and saying it's all my fault. You've convicted me for being priced three times. Priced three times. You never give me a defense. You never let me call one witness. How could the district attorney be anything other than the fair child of the world and be the winner when he's got me handcuffed, locked in the back room, and he's made a deal with Israel so they can have machine guns and what's that other guy's name? Saran, whatever, what did you name him?
Saddam Hussein.
Saddam Hussein, yeah, he got rocks to fly to shoot around, you dig? So all the people that keep stabbing everybody on the back over on this plate in the courtrooms that you call justice, when Rusty's got my gun out there on the highway in Lochner's court, because he was the bailiff. You see what I'm saying? In other words, I'm a spider with a lot of legs doing a lot of different things. And all you people who keep putting that shit out on the air, I'm going to give you another reason why I'm here. I'm here to help you a little bit. Because the guy next door to me said, Charlie, I know you, and I like you. And you've helped me out of a few tight situations, and I owe you one. I said, what's that? He said, I seen that show on TV the other day, and that's wrong. I get out in 8 months. Is there anything you want me to do? Now, what do you want me to tell him? Do you want me to tell him to come and see you? Do you want me to be the guy you're trying to make me? Do you want me to be the guy that orders people to die? Do you want me to be the dispensation of life and death? You convicted me for dispensating life and death, man. The fucking president of the United States can't even do that. The fucking Chinese don't even have the power to take over people's minds and control them. How the hell are you going to convict me for doing things you can't do? You convicted me for being father of this country, man. You gave Nixon my doom buggy. He put it up on the moon and played another act over on somebody else's game. And then what are you doing to me? You're locking me up and I got to carry all the insecurity, all the fear, all the doubt. Oh, I gotta carry the whole thing on my back. Not only do I carry it once, I carry it through. And when I carry it through, you're supposed to pay me. You don't pay me, Dukakis. You cheat me. You let the black people out. You let the Mexican people out. Then you throw me back down to represent the white people. And you say, here, guy, you're gonna hold another wave of racial balance for us. Then I have to hold all your fears and insecurities on the dark side where the knives run, where the dynamite's going up and down the road, where there's all kinds of insanity. On the Charlie Ho Man Shin Trail, when the U-2 pilot was busted in China, or when it was, no, Russia, when Powers was busted in Russia, I was in the same position I'm in now. The only thing is you changed wars, and instead of a U-2 pilot plane, you've got now flying in the sky a plane called AGWA.
You know, when you're talking about the money thing, we've been served notice by a gentleman who I'm sure you're familiar with named Robert Hendrickson, who shot what was called a documentary movie. It's called Manson. It's out in the theater. There's another man involved in that named Mary.
Yeah.
He's now dead. And we used a couple of short clips from that movie, and we tried to find this guy. Now he's found out. Awesome. I'd like one to get the tapes changed.
That?
Find out if you were satisfied with what they did in that movie.
I never watched none of that. I never see that.
You're aware of the movie.
Yeah, I'm not hung up on myself.
They
snuck around the back and they stole everybody's stuff. They stole stuff from people, they lied to people, they cheated people, they burglarized people's houses. They did all kinds of devious trips to make that movie. They did all kinds of bad things to make that movie.
Did they have an understanding with you before they started shooting? Did they come to you?
No. Nobody has. They just brought another Marine off the island. Every time they bring a Marine off the island, it's the head of this country. And they brought it off the island, and Bouliosis signed his name to another book, where a convict got out of jail and went to the island and lived with the Marine.
Yeah, I just read the first half of it.
Yeah, well, now here's the thing. They're living all in that fantasy land, and they're taking your minds off into that garbage can. That's pure bullshit.
Well, there's a movie being made of that book also.
But it's all fantasy. Your whole lives have become entertainment, and you've lost sight of reality, man. You can't even get to the public's mind unless you go through Entertainment Tonight. And then when you go through Entertainment Tonight, you know what they do with the film? They take it to Czechoslovakia and shoot their leaders. Because they see that what I'm saying is true. You're gonna die, man. You got movies about the mafia talking about how we're going to make this hit. You got movies about James Cagney and all these guys, but the reality of that is that at, on some levels, that was a reality, man. Some things you cannot do. You cannot steal my music. If you steal my music, you got God to contend with. And you don't even know what God is, and you don't even believe in God.
What would you like to happen to your music?
Whatever happens to it, don't change it around. You change it around, you're changing the voice of God. Because I'm that messenger.
There's a message in your music.
There's an assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum salam. I would say there's a message in my music, sure. Elijah Muhammad, Daddy Grace, soup kitchen in Chicago. I would say, yeah, I'm juvenile hall with Father Divine. They had a soup kitchen over there on Clark Street. That's how long I've been fighting. I've been fighting since I left the Irish monks in Terre Haute, Indiana. And I haven't lost a fight yet. I lost one fight in my life. There's one guy alive and whipping. That's because I can't find him. He's in Wheeling, West Virginia. And I don't think he'll let me find him. I might be able to find him. But I'm going to tell you something. When you do something to me, you might think you get away with it. But the ghost will tell you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, you don't get away with nothing, man. You can't hide nothing, nowhere on this planet. There's no place on this earth you're going to get away with anything. Not one lie you're going to get away with. We're working on a new system of prison. It's called four-point restraint. We lock people in coffins, and we stand them up against the wall and leave them there until they change their minds and start thinking about the right way. The only thing a prison is supposed to be is Christian kind of justice, to give you another chance, to give you a start. It's the love of Jesus Christ that gives you this penitentiary. If it wasn't for the love of Jesus Christ, you'd just line up against the wall and shoot you. See, they told you in L.A. that was Charles Older's courtroom. That wasn't Charles Older's courtroom. It was my courtroom. He had the judge's robe on, but I was the judge. That's the reason they overturned the death penalty. Because I was a brother in the hallway in the federal penitentiary, because I run a barbershop. And I bounce a handball. Ain't nobody ever beat me playing handball.
What's your opinion of the fact that you got 299 people on death row, and you're not one of them because of a certain period of time, that Supreme Court decision?
It was my decision. It had nothing to do with the Supreme Court. I'm the Supreme
Court.
Sentence
was commuted to life.
Wake up, goddammit! Ain't you got enough sense to look at it? Supreme Court was started when there was 13 million people in this country. You got 9 judges. With 13 million people, you got 250 million people. How the hell are you going to take one little Supreme Court with 9 chicken shit assholes and make a court out for 200 million people? It's impossible, man. Your government is a shell of madness that you're preaching off in schools. It's unreal. It's not real, guy. It's a game. It's entertainment.
Do you believe in the death penalty?
Death penalty?
Is it a deterrent?
No, what, deterrent from what? Deterrent from what, guy?
Death penalty prevents people from murdering people?
From murdering people. Where are you going to start? Where are you going to put the axe at? We got the hatchet. Where do you want to put it?
299 people on death row. They shouldn't be there.
No. What you raise them up to do? They're babies. You got a baby in a cradle. You're telling them, baby, won't you light my fire? Baby, won't you want a revolution? Why don't you do it in the road, kid? Go over there and do that, son. Go over there and do that. And all the kids run around. You lead them off into the nut wards, and they're in their fucking nut wards, cutting their wrists right, and I love you, Beatles, all over the wall, hanging themselves. And the Queen of England said, how much money did we make on that? How comes they got music in this country coming from England? How comes there ain't no white music in this country coming from this country? How comes only black music comes from this country? Because Johnny Carson gives Doc Severson 50 cents, and he gives the Jews the balls in this country. And they give him the action on the music. He's got all the young girls. He gets all the pussy. I have to stay on the motorcycle and catch what I can out in the dark side on another dream. You guys are all screwed up in your heads, man. You're selling your own asshole back through your asshole at least 3 times. You have no idea what the hell you're doing. Now you're coming up with this David Letterman and that stupid-ass Paul Schaefer, man. All he did was steal my music and come back and talk about somebody from Maude because she got another thing, and that guy that played on Henson didn't bring a taxi from New York. He owes me 9 taxi cabs. How many times do you think it would take to cut his heads off? If we started putting out death penalties where they belong, we'd have to dig Elvis Presley up for taking my guitar and beat on his bones for a while, wouldn't we?
What kind of music do you like to listen to?
All music. I love all music. Angel music. I like classical music. I like Beethoven. I like all music. I like the ballet. I like everything that has anything to do with class.
How about pop music? Madonna, Michael Jackson?
I don't know. That's not my generation. My generation is Bing Crosby. my generation is when your studio is moving fast and hard. My generation is Mills Brothers up the Lazy River by the old mill run. I'm still in that. You don't realize how much the music has over the mind. The music controls the minds of your children. If you go out of the desert, you see the donkeys. I used to watch the donkeys. All the chinny donkeys will get in the middle. And all the male donkeys will get off in the mountains and they'll sing. They don't fight each other, they just sing. And then the chinny donkeys go to the donkeys that sing the best. And it's pretty much the same thing. What you're selling with Michael Jackson is you're selling that black man's blood. You're mixing blood with Michael Jackson. You're putting him up to be like you did Elvis Presley when you were selling the Indians, when you put half Indian up.
You don't approve of the way that Michael Jackson is?
I don't approve, disapprove of anything.
You're not a Michael Jackson fan.
I like Michael. I like all Michaels. Michaels, all the Michaels of the world are angels. I don't dislike it. It's a kind of a waste of time.
You were talking a minute ago about Judge Holder trial. Is that something that you still think about every day? Still think about a lot?
It's in my mind, and for me, forever, for always. I'm forever guy. You know, I come on the set, everybody's going, I come in going, they say, what are you doing? You're crazy. You say, no, that's just what I do. And they say, well, look at that guy, he's no good, he's crazy. And then pretty soon, I leave, and they're all going, and I go back, and I say, hey, you're only doing what I was doing. You're only doing what I was doing. You're only playing cool because I said cool out to be played. You only, Fonzberg wasn't really the Fonz. You only play acting my lane. You only play acting my cool. You only guess the little get wrong. That's the yes and doobly boom bomb. Man, yes, that's the bullet back and roll a whole wall. I live 1,000 years a day, man. Why won't slow down and look at something too? You know, you steal me, you copy me, you play me. You run me off to be somebody else and change my name. Then you change my color. Then you give my guitar to somebody else and James Brown comes out and tells you, I'm your soul father. And then all my kids are dancing to James Brown. And who's James Brown's kids dancing to? And what's that African lady doing over there starving? She don't even wear no shoes. But then you bring me a half white, half black woman. You tell me, here, I got nice Saks Fifth Avenue shoes. I got diamonds. I got a new car for you. I got a Rolls Royce. You want to drive around? And I said, well, I'd rather have a cornfield. I'll take the woman with no shoes because she can feed me. See, all you can do is give me things. And those things ain't going to be lasting too much longer. I want to get over here on the ground. I want to go out in the desert and plant some trees. I want to secure my uniform. I don't care about your politics. I'm not going to vote for you. I don't give a fuck if you like me or not. As far as killing anybody, I kill anybody I want every time I get the chance if I feel like that's what I want to do.
Are you saying you're still dangerous?
Whatever. I wouldn't be dangerous to anybody that told the truth. I wouldn't be dangerous to children. I wouldn't be dangerous to anybody that was right. But anybody that was wrong, I'd say this. I'd say Hussein's a good guy. Because if I was in control of things, I wouldn't wait to bomb the citizens. I'd have been off on you a long time ago. Because too many people, you got to get rid of them some way. So why don't you make another church and kill your babies? That's what you're doing, ain't
it? What's your prediction for this country, let's say? Whatever you 2000, keep... What are your predictions?
Whatever you keep blaming me for, is a prediction of what you're going to live in. Whatever you're blaming me for, however you're judging me, is where you're going to end up. Because I've already slipped that noose. You know what a bullfighter is? He puts a little rag out there, and two of these big old horns come down, and he just flips that rag right on there. And he beats them horns every time. And every time he beats them horns, he's laughing at the world, because they're all scared. But he has no fear, because he's a man. If you stood in the bully of Spain, and you looked up at the crowd, all standing and cheering, throwing all the roses of the world at your feet. Look and you know that you are a man. I have not done that, but I walked his dog once.
When you first put back in 1969. If you think that over 20 years later, you have people from Europe, from Hollywood, and people from all over the country still coming to interview you, did you expect that people would know who Charles Manson was more than 20 years later?
I live right now. I'm standing on the end of the nose. You know, I don't live like that. I don't think like that. I'm hurt. I'm everything. I'm nothing. I'm real. I'm a bug. I lived in a cell with a roach. And I lived together for 14 years. He's lasted 6,000 years. 14,000 years, that's a long time.
Spending a lot of time in your cell, what do? Do you read?
I sing.
The radio?
I sing. What do you want to sing?
Your own song.
What do you want to sing? Crowe God, crossing Gaston Burn on a highway, rolling down on my way, I'll be home soon. And then I sing a little telephone story. You tell that motherfucker I'm lost in the telephone. Get up on the phone, boy. I'm trying to roll a little steady bend on now. You show me
right. You know, I haven't asked you anything at all about religion. Charles Tex Watson has become a minister.
Praise the Lord.
Do you know about that?
If it works for him, figure it out. Get on. If the wheel rolls, man, like, what can I say?
Would you like to join his congregation?
I'm already in his congregation, I thought. I've never had anything against Tex. Tex's been all right with me. Tex kept his word. Tex has some problems. I'll run something out real quick to you. Tex has some problems. He come to me and said, I can't deal with this, man. He said, it's too big for me. Will you help me? I said, what is it? He said, go down and face this guy. He's big, he's tough, he's ugly, he's mean. I said, face your problem, son. He said, I can't. You'll kill me. Will you help me? I said, yeah, I'll help you. So I take a gun, and I stand in Texas' place, and I walk. I say, I'm standing in Texas' place, and you took his money, give his money back. Whatever, I was standing in a whole episode with a guy called Lotsapopa. I had to shoot Lotsapopa. I told him, don't make me shoot you, man. I had to go through some changes, so I shot a man. I don't like shooting people. I don't like hurting people. But if I have to, I do. Whatever I have to do, just like all men do. So when I went and I came back, I said, you owe me one. You owe me one. You'll pay me sooner or later, one way or another. Take your time. Take your time, as much time as you want, but you'll pay me the one you owe me, or God will catch up with you. Because I'm a man of God also.
And were you repaid?
Huh?
Were you repaid?
Yeah, but it didn't happen that way. Bobby gets in a fight with another dude over a bagpipe. Bagpipes, I'm very serious about bagpipes because bagpipes are like my heart. I will fight over bagpipes if necessary because I like bagpipes. I like the music of bagpipes. It's like a guitar. It means a lot for the Spanish man because the guitar is his soul. Well, the bagpipes mean a lot to a Scotsman because the bagpipes are his soul. So we get, there's a lot of bikers and there's a helmet involved, there's a chrome helmet and two bayonets and the Hessians are involved and the straight Satans are involved and the Satan slaves are involved. And Bobby asked me if I would help him as a brother. And I told him, sure, I'll help you as a brother. He said, this guy's got a gun, what do I do? I said, don't reach for the gun because that puts his mind on the gun and he'll shoot you. I said, smack him in the mouth first. Put his mind on the mouth, on the smack, and then grab the gun. You can take it in a second, and you can beat him out of that gun. Well, I'm not going to do that. I said, what if you're afraid, come back over here and lay down. He said, well, I'm not afraid. I said, you should show me, brother. And he invoked me. He said, if you're a brother, show me you're a brother, and come and help me. So I said, all right. So I went over and I said, don't ever invoke me into no violence. You invoke me into violence, I got to go back to that penitentiary. I don't want to get involved. I don't want to break no laws, man. Because the old man told me, if you don't break the law, you don't have to go back to jail. So I'm not breaking no law. I'm staying right on this line and keep breaking the law. So to make a long story short, I took the gun away from the guy. The guy shot in the wall. When I took the gun away, I threw the gun back to the guy. I said, now I got to kill this fool. Because if I don't kill him, he's going to tell my parole officer I'm going back to jail. He said, no, don't kill me, man. I said, the only way I get away without killing you is you give me your word that you won't tell. You can come in my world. He said, I give you my word. I won't tell. I said, come on in my world then. You live in my world because I don't tell either. There's a world that you don't live in where people don't snitch on each other. We don't rat on each other. We don't tell on each other. We don't write no notes. You see what I'm saying? That world is in motions. It exists in procedure. It exists in uniform and military. It's not in words. It's in the wave of your hand. It's in the reflection of motions. It's in the circle that you don't know anything about unless you're raised up in the military. You can understand that. So then I cut the guy's ear off. We put the guy's ear back on with some scotch tape and we patch him all up. He promises he won't tell. I said, why don't you make your debts and pay your debts and be a man, man? Why you gotta lie to this kid? You owe him money. We're not wrong, you're wrong. You're trying to get somebody to make a man out of you, to make your word good. Your word is all you are. If you ain't got no word, you ain't no good. If you ain't no good, you ain't worth living. Because what the hell are you without your word? You stand on your word, man. You give this kid your word, you make your word good. If you don't, I'm gonna have to come after you again because that's my brother. My brother's me and I am my brother. And I'm standing in his place. I stood in Texas' place facing his death. I stood in Sandy's place facing her death. I fought three people for Susie facing her death. I fought all kinds of different people facing their problems. And I never realized what was building up in the implied agreement of the circle in the occult, what you call the occult. So when it came back into play, the guy got the gun back from Bobby, and he said, I'm going to go kill that little fart. Bobby said, I won't let you kill him. The guy said, he cut my ear off. Bobby said, the man stood up for me. Now I'm standing up for him. He said, no, I don't want you, I want him. He said, he was doing what he was doing for me. And he handed the guy a Mexican knife with a big eagle on it. And he told the guy, you can kill me. Because now I know he stood up for me. I'll stand up for him back. And the guy says, I don't want you. So Bobby took the gun away from him and stabbed him in the heart and killed him.
And I think now at parole hearings, he says that you did it.
It doesn't matter what he said. I know what happened. It doesn't matter what people say. What people say is what they say for themselves. Everybody's working for themselves, aren't they?
You just said, you just mentioned the circle and the occult and so forth. Can you talk about that, what you meant about that?
Well, whenever someone does something for you, you owe them that back. If you let them do it.
That's not really a cult anything, a cult about that.
That's a circle of implied agreement. Applied agreement is a spiritual circle of monks that have hoods that give their lives to God, man. And you must serve that. If you don't serve it, you're not in line with yourself. That's the implied agreement. Where do you think I'm coming from? I'm coming from Father Jabal's order in Terre Haute, Indiana. It's full of monks. They set me, they raised me. They taught me how to play handball and paddled me when I lied. They set me out on the road. I ran away from them at 13 years old, and I'm still running from them.
I got two questions about the prison policy thing here. I just want to make sure we're about the tape. Are we okay?
Will you let me finish?
Yeah. I just want to make sure because the tape is running out.
9 minutes left.
Yeah, let's go ahead and roll. Let's pick up. Just wait a second. If everybody's rolling,
yeah.
Go ahead on.
So, Twenty years does a lot to people. It changes their minds about a lot of things. And when they can see that they might be able to tell a few lies and get out the door, not too many people won't tell the lies to get out the door.
Would you blame them if the lies were
about you? I wouldn't blame them if whatever they did, I don't blame them. I don't blame. I don't carry blames. I'm not a blamer.
You can take the rap as they...
Take the rap as a tap. That don't mean a bottom tap. That ain't about shit. Listen, the dude came back and said to me, he said this, it's cool, because I killed the dude. He come and give me the knife. He said, what do I do? I said, Jesus Christ. Now you got me involved in bullshit. When he killed a dude, that got me involved if accessory after the fact. That's the most that you could have convicted me for, is accessory after the fact. Because all the judgments that I had made in the 2.5 years that I was in Los Angeles are only the judgments that I was taught by the man. Only the judgments that I was taught by the brother. Only the judgments that I was taught by God. And I know what the court is, and I know what judgments are, and I know the guidelines of life and death, and I know the dispensation of that life and death. Now listen, when Bobby stood up for my life, after I stood up for his life, I owed Bobby one, Tex owed me one. I crossed both legs, and I said, Tex, you pay Bobby what you owe me. You owe Bobby one, pay him. He said, how do I pay him? I said, don't bother me. I'm busy. I don't care how you pay him. It's none of my business. You make a mistake in letting me do something for you. You're dealing with the devil, mister. I don't cut no slack in my act. I don't play no bullshit with nobody. I don't lie. I don't want to be lied to. I don't fake. I don't want anyone faking on me. You do me right, you'll get right back. You don't do me right, you'll get it sooner or later. So whatever you do it to yourself. It doesn't matter. If I'm helping you, and I'm serving you, and I can't serve you right, then evidently there's something inside of you that ain't right. Because all I'm doing is serving what you asked me to do. It's the same thing with Tex. Tex kept his word all the way to that gas chamber. As far as I'm concerned, Tex is a man, and Tex is okay. Tex never took no witness stand on me until he said anything bad about me. Nobody but Linda Kasabian said anything bad, and it took him 17 days to pump that out of her. And all she said was, I think he said, go in there and kill somebody. Well, she could think pink elephants until Mama Africa comes home, and it still doesn't make elephants pink.
Is Linda Kasabian in any kind of trouble?
Is Linda, I don't know. I imagine Linda Kasabian has to do whatever Linda Kasabian does. I'm not in the business of judging people, man. Not really, you know. I'm not in the business of blaming or condemning, criticizing or going through all that insanity. I live in the world of right now, what is, and I don't.
You've got no grudge against Linda Kasabian. She helped put you behind bars.
For what? For what?
For testifying against you.
Against me for, she testifies, she has to live with what she does. She has to live with what she says. Her waters are not running.
And she's not in any danger from you.
Why should be? Why should she be? She gave me her daughter.
What about?
Oh, I'm still scared.
What about your kids?
You got a daughter right over here.
What about your son? 23, 24 years old, back in New York State. Have you ever talked to him? Has he ever tried to contact you?
I've got a whole lot of sons, guy. I got a whole tier full of sons.
And this guy said,
I got a whole prison full of sons.
No, I'm talking about a guy who's here.
Hey!
Yeah, what about that?
I don't mind. Still no more. Candles from the world that high for you, go now. Stop. See me, you don't reflect me. You come to me and say, hey, I'm your sir. I don't know who you are. You know, you don't belong to me. You ain't got nothing to do with me. I don't even know you, man. How could you be my way?
You're not curious about?
Curious about what?
About what he's like.
So why should I be curious?
What? Isn't it?
If you know everything, there's nothing to be curious about.
You don't want to talk to him?
I am talking to him. Right now. You'll listen. What would I say to him? The same thing I would say to him anyway. You're all medicine. You're all my children. You convicted me for being a father. I told the judge, hey, man, did you see what you're doing here? He said, I said, look, man, you're convicting me for being responsible for everything, man. Go out and get a defense. Can I call in witnesses? So when Tex and I went in to the Bunyanka house, there was a little dog out there, and it's funny, dogs just never barked at me for some reason. I grew up in the worst neighborhoods and the dogs just never say nothing, man.
Did the dog live?
The dog live? I don't know. I went in, we went in, and Mr. Bunyanka was sitting at the couch. I asked him if he had the black phone book. one from New York City that he owed. Here we go, the guy called Frankie Carmo.
It was an organized crime thing.
Yeah.
But what was put out was that you never knew Lino Bacalagno before you went into
that. I didn't. I knew Frankie Carmo. Frankie Carmo.
Everybody said that you picked that house by chance.
I picked what house by chance?
The LaBianca house.
Everything reduced by chance or nothing's by chance. All is perfection. Want to dance, what romance.
Go on, I interrupt. I interrupt. I interrupt. Black phone book.
And he said, well, I know about the black phone book. And I told him, I was sent from God to get the black phone book. I told him, don't lie or die. Yeah, I got the phone book. I said, give it up. I'm God's father now. So he gave me the phone book.
Then why did you get killed?
I don't know. I was scared about that.
We're talking about Tex. I'm no expert on prison policy, but as I understand it, Tex Watson has a wife and three kids by way of conjugal. Tex Watson has a wife and three kids by way of conjugal visits since he's been in prison. And that the policy here is that you don't have any physical contact with anybody if you talk to them through a glass. How does it happen that Tex Watson has three kids and you don't even have any physical contact with anybody?
I guess Tex is smarter than me. Tex is a pretty smart boy. He's got a college education. He reads and writes pretty good. All them guys are pretty good. If you're stupid in jail, man, you're locked up all the time. You gotta be smart in jail to get out of the line. I'm not too smart. I'm smart on the back of a motorcycle, and I play good music. But other than that, I'm stupid. I mean, I don't know how to even write that well. I'm a dumb hillbilly. I'm pretty stupid. I'm still in grade school truth. I'm still in Sunday school truth. I still believe in God. That's how stupid I am. You don't even have to be stupid to believe in God.
Well, I started in on there. I want to pick that up, but I think we got to change. Change tips in a second.
You're going to cut this up and make me look like a villain again?
I'm going to present what you say. As fair as we can, I think you've been quite honest. You've been talking about all these things and setting the record straight.
Okay, let's look at it this way. They convicted me in a press. They didn't convict me in the courts. They convicted me in the media.
You took those first days on the question. Or is that the word in the prophets?
No one bars. I'm going.
Four. You have bars on these already?
No. You got four.
You want this? Channel 2.
She okay?
I don't think she was just going to check the tapes and stay out.
At the truck?
Just at the truck. And is that all right with the guard?
She's
come back if you'd like, whatever you'd like.
What truck are we talking about?
It's 30.
You had a man on the mountain.
Yeah.
Yelling at the top of his voice. Everything that is coming becomes extinct.
That's how.
He would be saying, the beetle bug's dying in Virginia. Cobblestone in South Africa won't live no more. Most in the mountains of Australia, the bumblebee bug is leaving. The buzz of the moon butterfly is not living anymore. Model gallstone are gone. The platypus gallstone. The bumblebee gallstone. And he'd be yelling at the top of his voice as fast as he could. That's how fast things are becoming extinct. Like this. 6 to 7 billion trees cut today. You cut a tree down and make a desk with it. You don't think about it. It's just your way of lifestyle. You cut a 600-year-old tree down. It took 600 years to build that tree. That's 600 years worth of energy that you've taken from the earth. And all that was living from that tree, like the birds and the worms and the germs and the bugs and the bees and all the different little creatures that make our atmosphere, you've killed them all. And you've been doing this since you landed in Plymouth Rock. You've been destroying this whole rainforest. And you just about got it all into cement. And there's going to be nothing left. Your water in California is just about all dammed up or in aqueducts. You can't get no precipitation into the sky without some vegetation.
you look at the land and you say, wow, man, you people are destroying the whole planet, and you're all going to die. You're killing everybody. Someone says, well, you got to die sometimes. Pull it up and check the oil, will you? They really don't care.
When did all this concern about, I know I've heard for years that you've been talking about this, AWWA and the environment. When did that come to you, and how did it come to you? When did you start to become
When I completed myself in Mexico, I ran with an old Indian who gave me some mushrooms, and we went up on top of a pyramid. And he said, you see the water there where I used to fish? He said, there's no fish. He said, I used to put the water in my, wash my hands, but I can't touch it because I break out. He said, in America, you got factories and sewer plants that clean your water, but down here, we're poor. We can't afford that. And the water that's dying, we're dying with the water because we have to drink the water straight from the earth. We can't get up over you guys because you buy what we make. You send it back to the United States and stamp made in the United States and sell it back to us. You're killing us. You're destroying us a little bit at a time. You go to the office building of the United States in Mexico, it's much bigger than the office building of the president of Mexico. The United States runs Mexico. They run Latin America. And we can't, even when we got General Noriega up over there a little bit, then they had to come down and take him out of the play. We're still in the same battle we was when my grandfather had a long Kentucky rifle, and Pancho Villa was out in the field against the United States gringos, green coats, when they said, stay on the land. You're taking the children off the land. You're destroying the children's minds and in schools. And you're taking the people off the land. You're taking the land. You're going to lose the land. You're going to lose the people. Grandpa died and went to hell. He lives with a bell in his hand in the graveyard in Kentucky. That's the reason they ring the bell in San Quentin over the ghost of my father's. The same principle runs through West Virginia, Tennessee, when they brought the Tennessee Valley authorities in. My Uncle Wormy died in the nothing. So as many men that lived on the hoe, that worked in the fields, that picked up the guns for revolution to keep the people down on the ground and stop this bureaucratical goddamn fucking freeways concrete system that you're destroying the planet with. But every time we get the CC camps going, it took us 20 years to get the CC camps going. Squeaky Lynette Fromm gave her youth. She gave her young life to get the CC camps going. Sandy gave her life to get the CC camps going. All of them children that you look at and call bad, they gave their whole self for what we were doing. And the murders, I took full advantage of them in every way I could. I painted a picture with them. I drew lines with them. I used their bodies in all kinds of directions. I hung a for sale sign up over the body of Sharon Tate. And I said, I will take advantage of everything I can to save my world. The world I live in, I will do just about anything that my scheming, conniving mind can scheme and connive, I will do.
How was Sharon Tate threatening the world?
Sharon Tate was not threatening my world. Sharon Tate was daughter of Colonel Tate.
Colonel Tate, the mother by
Colonel Tate was the Army. My father is Colonel Army from Kentucky, not Polish from Rome. My father is a Colonel with a rifle from Kentucky, and it's his army. I don't make it, God does it.
But did you even know that Sharon Tate lived in that house?
Yeah, I knew Sharon was living there. I knew Sharon well.
You had known Sharon Tate before?
Sure.
How did you meet her?
I met her in Dennis's house two or three times. I met her in Elvis's house two or three times. I told you that's my neighborhood. There's not a rat moving in that neighborhood I don't know.
Do you have a grudge against her?
Grudge against her, no.
Like her?
I like her just like her.
Did you know that she was married to Polanski?
No. No. I knew she was in pornography. I knew she played with dogs a lot. And I knew she did a lot of things that you're probably going to prove. If you've really seen the occult, you'll probably take another look at the video films that they arrested and that Hugh Brenner bought back. Hugh Brenner paid $30,000 to get their take back of him and Ray Davies.
you still think about Sharon Tate today?
But why should I think about Sharon Tate today? You know how many people have died since Sharon Tate died? You know what I've got? I've got an idiot district attorney that follows me around. He's followed me around for 21 years. And he acts like he really likes Sharon Tate. Why is he acting like he likes Sharon Tate? Because he wants the publicity, because he wants to run for attorney general. He wants to be a little pissed. It's all a blood sucker. They suck the blood of those people. Look here, look here, look here. I had no way of knowing where Tex was going. I was in San Diego when Tex made his move. When Tex made that move, I had a traffic ticket in San Diego.
If you knew Tex was going to Sharon Tate's house, would you have stopped him?
No, no. And I'll tell you what. Anybody in prison will tell you, Mr. A and Mr. B's in the cell. Mr. A says, I'm gonna hang myself. Mr. B says, I won't let you. So Mr. A kills Mr. B and hangs himself anyway. There's a knife on that yard, and Joe Blow's gonna make a move on Tom Green. You get in the way, you're gonna get moved on. You walk your line, life. Life has a line. Remember that song, I keep a close watch on this heart of mine? I walk the line because you're mine. Yeah, yeah, well, there's the truth in that. The truth is, if you walk the line in prison and you don't get on nobody else's line, 9 chances out of 10, man, I'd bother you. Anybody that gets up on your line, you really don't have to worry about them. Because there's only one person you got to worry about in prison, and that's the man. And he's generally in uniform. So you really don't have to worry about too much. You know, you don't have to if you walk in the line. Well, I walk the line. The guy comes up and says, I'm going to rob the First National Bank. I tell him, yeah. That's cool. That's cool. Yeah. He said, you want to help me? I said, what's the plan? He showed me the plan. I looked at it. I said, no, don't look too cool to me. I'm not stepping into that. I won't bite off into that. It's too raw. So if he says, if I say, yeah, all right, I'll help you, and I step into it, then I'm all the way in it. And if I give you my word, it's my life. If I say the getaway car will be there at 8 o'clock, the getaway car will be there. You see what I'm saying? In other words, that's the world I live in. Where if you give your word is your bond, and your bond is your life, you know. You guys don't live in it. You live in another.
I want to come back to what you were just saying about the DA who follows you around and speaks. He says, and this is what we were talking about religion earlier in the interview, you said you believe in God. The DA who follows you around says, he doesn't say you're a Satanist, but he says you've become the champion of all the Satanists in the country are gravitating toward you.
Okay.
Set me straight on Charles Manson and religion. I want to hear it from you because we
well,
heard from him.
I'm handcuffed. That's a religion, man. The big man over there is religion. As long as I'm handcuffed. And I'm on that handcuffed. And I'm religious.
But I'll just keep after you on it if you don't want to answer it. That's okay, too. Let me put out one more quote. It said, come other words. It said that Tex Watson said, and I'm not saying that you said it, but you're saying that Tex Watson is quoted as saying when he was in the Tate House, I'm the devil, and I'm here to do the devil's business.
Okay.
Does that mean that the Manson family were a group of Satanists?
I would imagine the devil's in everyone, isn't it? What is the devil to you? What's the word, the definition, semantic? The devil is doubt and fear, insecurity. The devil runs in, he's not sure. The devil is generally a woman, most ways you want to look at it. Then you can look at it from the other eye and you say, the woman is generally Christ. Christ is the woman, and Christ is the devil. The devil is the woman, and how are you going to draw the line on it? It's interpretation. Everybody's got their own interpretation on it. There's Abraxas, that's what they call me, in the back. Abraxas. That's the cross going one way in the light, and the cross going the other way in the darkness. One cross one way, the other cross upside down.
Do you believe in the concept of heaven and hell?
Well, I believe in the concept of yin and yang, big and bong, and rattle, stustin, to guess the boom, bong, and roll, and then I got the stustin, and get the flow on. I believe in Obama, and I'm finding a song stand, and other things that you've only put in the depths of it. But you don't know about Arms Landing because you've got a friend around, they didn't tell you about that. But they got the esoteric, and then they got the fossil berry, and the rock of vegetables, the fat fence. And then what's time with a bone bolster? You never had a false knowledge because they didn't tell you about it. It was another peak. It went so high, they were just freaked out. They went, oh, wow, man, I didn't know that. I didn't know you were in there. I said, if I would have known that, I would have had you out a long time ago. I'm sorry, please, Lord, forgive me. And I said, I don't forgive. I'm not in the business of forgiving. You're out of line. You've got no slack. Got too many, too way. I just got no time for it, man. I'm sorry. Goodbye. There's nothing I can say. And then you go in the cell, and hang themselves. What can I say? What can I say? What do you want me to do? Be the savior of the world? Is that what you're looking for? You convict me for being the savior of the world? Is that what you want? Or do you want the destroyer of the world? Or which is the difference? Or how could the savior of the world do anything but destroy you? Look at you. Look at what you do in my image on the TV. You make me to be a clown. Look, you got garbage all over your face. You come in, you're dealing with garbage, man. You play acting that goddamn horseshit off through those people's minds, and then it comes back through them stars, and I got to labor. I can't even get on the main line. I can't have a comb to comb my hair. I can't have a mirror. I can't have anything. They give my guitar to James Brown because the black people are scared of the white people. The white people are scared to death. So they run and give my guitar to the black people and say, we're sorry, we don't want to offend you. You know, and then where do I go? How am I to do? I got to whip the white people up into shape to keep them up balanced with the black people because they're scared. I got to carry this fear on this foot, carry that fear on that foot, and then I got to go up down the hallway handcuffed to where some witch has got a hammer over here bound on the thing looking at me. Somebody else got a screwdriver doing some other thing. And it's okay if I'm afraid. It's okay if I'm insecure. What could I be, man? What could I be but a pile of numbers and all the money in your pocket?
But don't you think the people in here are afraid of you because of that reputation?
People are afraid and they're just laying it over on me because you're giving them that to do with it. You're giving them an excuse to do it on TV.
But I mean, seriously, doesn't that help you to have that kind of reputation here that people leave?
No, hell no, fear don't help nobody. I mean, fear would help me if I was Bush. Give me a 4 stars on my shoulder. Give me that uniform and put stars on my shoulder. Then I can have the authority that I am, and I can stand up and be what I am. And in essence, that this eye is World War I, this eye is World War II, and that the body that I am in is the toes in one shoe.
What does it stand for?
That means World War II. My dad went over there and took it away from the Germans. It belongs to me now. I can say whatever I want to say to it. It does whatever I say to it. It's mine.
Aren't you afraid people are going to think that means I am a Nazi? I'm an American Nazi.
I don't care what people think. Women think. The man don't need to think. He knows.
Have you ever been tempted to get rid of this? Some days you wake up.
I was tempted when it got burned off.
Christian,
yeah.
Burn your forehead?
Yeah.
Did you put it back on?
Yeah.
What were you thinking about that day?
I was thinking that the child was very confused and that the Prime Minister of India would be shot and killed for that. And that 3,600 people was burnt to death in the streets for it. And it was a shame that he had to do that to himself.
When these big news events happen, like you're talking about the war that's going on right now, and we brought a whole bunch of these headlines. We went to great length to find all these things: John Lennon, Jonestown, Nixon, Royal Honeymoon, all these kinds of things, Patty Hearst. All these things have happened since you've been behind bars.
Uh-huh.
How do you find out about these big news events?
I already know what's happening before it happens. I already know everything.
What's going to be the next big news event?
We're going to kill all the civilians.
In Iraq?
Everywhere in the world. There's only going to be uniform guy.
World War III?
No, the end of the world.
You really believe that's coming?
Yes, how can it? I mean, you've got eyes in your head, you've got ears to hear. A deaf and dumb Indian could tell you with his nose. He could smell it and tell you. You go over and sit on the hill on the side of L.A. and you listen to L.A. in the morning. You're the friend of and then you come back about 10 years later after you've been in jail and bling, 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 bling. You say, ooh, wow, man, you went up three notes. You went up three notes, man. That old town is lifted, you know. You go where there used to be grass over there, there's no grass there. They got apartment buildings. Oh, wow, man. You go where there used to be a filling station. Wow, man. You go where you say, well, you got a little patch of green over here. I mean, I don't know how you're going to breathe. Where are you going to get your air? You get your L.A. forest can't even got no trees in. The bees can't even live in L.A. The butterflies, you can't see the butterflies in L.A.
Let me ask you about it. We talked about the rest of the future, your own future. Do you expect to get out?
Out? I don't know. Out.
I mean,
I don't have any out in my mind, man. I am out. You're locked up. I tried to explain to you that was my courtroom. In the ghost of truth, in the world that you're in will fade and die. The world that I am, I still got dreams. I'm a beautiful woman. I'm a beautiful woman.
But you're not resigned to staying in here the rest of your life.
I'm not resigned. I'm not resigned to staying in here. In here to you is what's in here in your mind. Can't you understand that? In here to everyone has in here what is in here to their mind. That's got nothing to do with me. I may end up being a doctor in here, helping people. I wanted to open up a suicide clinic to where everybody that wanted to die could go and commit suicide. And it would be legal because a lot of people want to die. And they try to get you to kill them. And then if you kill them and you do them a favor by killing them, then you got to go to jail and go to death row for it. A lot of people on death row are only up on death row because other people pushed them into doing it. I've got a little brother that's been 14 years old when he came to jail. He didn't know anything of what he was doing. He's on death row waiting to die. He's never been outside since he was something like 14. And then he was only out, I think, a couple of years. The guy's never been out his whole life. And all he's done is what you put on him to do. You put stuff on people to do it, and then they do it, and then you blame them for it. You put poison in my ventilator, and then I gotta come out of the cell and fight the cops, and you say, look, that guy's no good, he's giving the cops a bad time. I'm pushed and pulled in a thousand different directions to do all kinds of things that I don't particularly want to do, but I don't have any choice. Do you? Do you have a choice? You say, yeah, I got a choice. I live in the land of freedom, home of the brave. No, you don't. In your mind, you're locked up in a book. You don't live anywhere. You're in the graveyard. You're all walking dead people, and you don't even know it. Your children try to raise up and tell you, you chew them on down and beat them to the ground. You got another war? You want to stop it? What are you going to do about Tex and Bobby and Susie and Betty and Harry and Larry? That's just in California. You're not talking about Georgia or Atlanta or Leavenworth or McNeil Island or Terre Haute, Indiana, Attica. What are you going to do about all them kids and all them prisoners that gave their energies and their lives to stop the Vietnam War? And then did your government tell you that Charlie on the Ho Man Shen Trail has not surrendered? And that war is still going on? Just because Nixon said it's over doesn't mean it's over. And just because Nixon went to China and said, I'll give you the rest of their heads if you let me live. No. You don't sell me out that easy. You know, I'm not dismissed that quick. It isn't what you think it is. I've got computers in Denver. I've got computers in Nuremberg. I've got trials and courts in the military. I've got the Navy to deal with. I've got all kinds of things that Bush is a little baby. Bush is a little girl. And you can tell Selleck and all them other people that keep playing my little girl off to make me a little girl in their world. I'm a little girl in their world. But over here, I'm still a stupid jarhead Marine. I'm still an Army Corporal. I'm still a Marine Drill Sergeant. I'm still in the uniform. I'm still in the Salvation Army, and I'm still out there on the railroad going over and getting a bowl of soup every once in a while and drinking some wine and walking up and down the alleys of your streets. I'm still here. Even if this body of Charlie Manson doesn't get up in the morning, God help you. I am here on this planet. What you make of me is what you get, what you see, and come to you.
Linda, letter, I think, was instrumental in the interview, so I just wondered whether she has any questions.
You wanted to ask me about the Beach Boys, I think.
Oh, yeah, about the Beach Boys. About Dennis Wilson and all that, and that whole music thing. I don't mean to be facetious, did you actually want to be a member of the Beach Boys? Be part of the band?
No. I got out of prison after 22 years in prison. Tanto tiempo disfrutamos este amor, nuestras almas se acercaron tanto así. I was singing.
Doesn't sound like a Beach Boys.
I was singing in the gardens of Chapultepec, Mexico City. I got along good with the Mexican music. I come into the American music to learn to play the American music. I've been playing the guitar for a lot of years, and I was in jail with a Jewish friend of mine. He turned me on to Universal Studios, where they had the big fire the other day, where the Mexican burnt the Universal Studios down, thank you. And they took my music and they burned it up. And they tore my music up, and here's why they tore my music up. Stromberg said that he wanted me to play with Hamisa Kayla from South Africa in the trumpet, and Big Black on the conga drums. I said, no, I'll play music by myself. And they said, well, you're a racist. I said, I don't know what a racist is. Stromberg was married to a Jewish girl on one side of town with three Jewish children. And he was married to a black girl on the other side of town with a singing career, Solid Gold. Solid Gold wanted one voice and one voice only. And they wanted to mix all races together and make one people. And they wanted to do that through the Universal Studios and the music. They said, you become a part of what we say and do what we say and enter into this agreement with us to do that. And you can have the music on the next movie that we're making, The Second Coming of Jesus Christ. This was before the movie came out, Jesus Christ Superstar. I was in Cary Grant's apartment because it was free rent, because Cary Grant was in London and he wouldn't be around, so I was living in his house for a while.
Who gave you that deal?
I did. I knew the homosexual that was a clerk, and she was a friend of mine, or he was a friend of mine, or we were like friends together, or however you want to play it. But that's where I was living. So, this guy sent me to Gary, and Gary was picking my mind like you're doing now, asking me what I was going to bounce the ball at the booby bop line, and he knew, along with this other guy, that I was in the Kreisstadt, because the Jewish have been feeding on the Kreisstadt for a lot of years, and they know things that they never tell the Christians. That the stock market in South Africa goes up when they sell the guns and make in the revolution. The Christian preachers get scared and they sell all their stocks. And then they'll pick the guns back up and the stock goes back up and then they'll sell them all back and they make a big profit. There's a whole thought in between those people that is just perpetrated and completely on money. And money is the only thing that they live for. I don't live for money. The money's all mine anyway. I live and dance in and out of the money as a play. But I really don't get serious with money because money is a game that I invented out of my mind a long time ago. My mind is really old. I got an old mind. So in this old mind of mine, I look at that little kids, and he wants to make the second coming of Jesus Christ, and I tell him the Quasi-Quarto is 2,000 years older than Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ is a little God in the universe, that the universe is a big, big universe, and there's all kinds of gods in there, man. I mean, there's gods in there that are older than David, you know? And I got nothing against nobody, but this is the game he wants to play, and he burnt my music up, and we ended up as leaving, but we weren't enemies, because I don't accept enemies that are alive. We left, he went his way and I went my way, and then a girl from a nuclear physicist and the nuclear mine came into play from the angels of the diamond market that came into my window and said, I belong here and I belong to you and here is a ring. She gave me a ring with a lion with a diamond in its mouth, and she said that I was hers. And I said, okay, I accept you. I said, go over and to my brother over there, take your clothes off and give yourself to him until I call you. So she went over to him and submitted to him and flew through the Bank of America. I think she's a president of the Bank of America somewhere now. And she's got my money off in some other games. And you see, in other words, I'm much more than the district attorney. His mind was about this big.
Well, you said you're living in Cary Grant's house, you're living in Dennis Wilson's house. Were there any other celebrities in those days that you were living with?
Was there any other celebrities that I wasn't with? It was my bed.
How about some other names?
It was my bed. No, I'm not a name dropper guy. Half the time I don't remember the people that, their faces go by,
but it's my bed, me and the African Queen. I mean, that's what the, what's it, what's that movie they made? Catherine Hepburn and what's his name?
Bogart,
yeah. Yeah, African Queen. Yeah, we went through that before. I mean, that's old, you know. Like, I told the district attorney, I'm already outside, and I'm brother, man. I don't know why we gotta keep playing these same old stupid things, because so many people are lying. By the time the truth catches up, the district attorney's head is gonna be probably on fire. Because I was standing in his place when the guy threw the fire on me. Because actually, I was Hare Krishna in 1954 out on Sunset Boulevard. If you go out there, you know that little retreat they got out there at the end of Sunset Boulevard? Yeah. We used to go out there. Paharasa Yogananda was there. That was back in the 40s. I don't look as old as I am. I'm pretty old. I'm so old. It's just... Is any of this communicating? Or is
very much so. Yeah. I just wonder whether there's anything more that you want to say, because I'm in pretty good shape.
Yeah, there's a couple. I think we need to change tapes. There's a couple things I want to
hear. Yeah, let's
go ahead and change tapes and then.
I see all these guards looking like they want to.
Let me tell you.
I'm not sure how much time I have as far as...
We have two more minutes, so just a couple quick things.
Right. Okay, right. Yeah. Do they, on your mail, they look at everything, they open everything and read it?
Yeah, they vulture down on the mail, yeah.
And are you sure that when people send you gifts and so forth, does it get through?
It doesn't matter if they get through. These cops are in my body anyway.
How many letters in a week from the same thing?
I don't know, it varies. I used to get about a couple, 200-300.
A week?
Yeah.
Now, Charlie, you said you were upset with our show Hard Copy that aired a couple weeks ago. Now, I want you to think about it, and I want you to complete the sentence for me. I want you to say, I'm upset with Hard Copy because, and tell me why. Say it like that.
I don't have a television in my house, and I'm upset with Hard Copy in this perspective.
Would you start that again for me?
Yeah.
Start it again for me.
I'm upset with Hard Copy on this level, from this perspective. Other inmates come to me and they say, Charlie, we didn't like what they said. We know different. See, you're supposedly a news program that's supposed to produce valid information into the public's eye. And you've got a lot of men in prison watching TV. You're playing your act to the people outside, and you don't realize that there's an inside watching also. And I liked you to start with on that program. Remember when I pinched you?
I remember that.
I pinched you for this reason right now, so I could tell you. I pinched you to show you that we were not in a dream. That this was reality. And I pinched you in the back when no one but me and you knew that I pinched you. So I like you. I think you're a good child. I think you're a good kid. And I think that guy that was working with you was a good kid. I think Bill was okay, you know. When you didn't send me a copy of the picture, I was a little upset. Then I figured, well, they must be busy, or maybe they blamed it on each other or whatever. But then I thought, if I let this ride, how many guys are gonna think about you? I've got a lot of friends. You would not believe how many people have come to realize that I got a bum rap on this.
On Hard Copy.
On the whole thing. But when you picked up the district attorney's case, you picked up the point. You picked up the whole thing and threw it on your back as if I'm ready to carry this. You know, you're carrying 20 years of insanity. You put it all back into proportion, like we're all the way back to 19, whatever it was, when this ding-dong thing started, you know? It's like, two or three other dudes said they didn't like it. Then I got a letter from a couple of my old ladies that just flew in from other places. And believe me, all of my friends that used to be nice little gentle flower children, they are very mad and mean old witches now, you dig? And they don't like a lot of the things that you people have been doing, see? So we want to try to get everything in line of where we're all in harmony and balance to where we can get a life going in this ship and get it to where we're going to survive. We got captain, lieutenants, majors. We got a few helicopters going. We got Blackhawks and we got Apaches. We got Captain Stereo and Uvalla. We got a lot of good things in this family. And I think you're a part of it. Whether you really want to be a part of it or not doesn't really matter. You're stuck in it. When you came in to interview, I gave you the interview. You made your little career, you got your little dusty bus going, you got to step up a couple road miles and that road, and you change your name again, la-la-la-ro, you know, whatever, you know. It's like a push-pull sort of thing, and then it's like, then you, when I come back, you body slam me, boom! I said, whoa, that don't sound like Linda Bell, man, I can't see that she would do that to me. So the guy from downstairs called me up, he said, hey, I'm writing those people a letter, I don't like that. Have you got any mail about them? Favorable or unfavorable? Yeah. And he said, I'm going to write him because that's a bunch of bunk, you know. And I said, all right. He said, you know the reason they crucified you? I said, why? He said, because you didn't answer their letter. They thought you didn't want to interview with them. I said, well, I couldn't. I was on four-point restraint over here working with some other procedure with some nuts in uniform.
Now, I understand that. Now, last thing I want to ask you. Is when we were at San Quentin, you sang a song to me and to Bill Stout. I believe it was an Elvis Presley song.
No, I wasn't.
Ain't Nothing Like a Hound Dog, was it?
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
No, I'm not going to that.
You won't sing a song for us?
No.
You
don't want to sing it? For my friends. I don't like many people.
You don't like us anymore?
Yeah, I like you a little bit.
Not sing an Elvis song for me.
Huh?
Sing an Elvis song.
I'll tell you what, man. You take the handcuffs off, give me a guitar, and I'll sing.
Well, sing. We can't do that. Just sing. Look into that camera and sing some Elvis for
me. No. You got to give me a little red nose. You got to put a little red nose on me, man. I'm not an entertainer, guy. I'm really not. If I say I like you, that means I might cuss you out. Because if I even cuss you out, that means I like you. Because I don't even speak to people I don't like. You know, you have to be in jail to understand me, man. I'm a mean old man. I'm a grouchy, lugubrious, lascivious dog. I'm no good at all. I'm just rotten. I'm terrible. I drink Scotch whiskey. I fall down. I stink. I don't shower as much as I should. I do all the bad things that are bad, man. I'm just no good at all.
Well, if you're not going to sing, I guess that's all I have.
Yeah.
Doug, you need anything else?
I think you got your points across on each.
Okay, let me gather something in here. I'd like to say a few things. And then I'd like to ask you all a question. Are you going to give me an uncut tape of this?
That can be done.
Okay. Write Sadler's down. Blue. 10, 13. Jensen, J-E-P-S-E-N, Corcoran, 9-3-1, whatever it is, 9-3-2-0. Yeah, would you send him another, and I give you my word on this. See, I live by my word. I give you my word that we'll not use it for any commercial things or play any commercial stuff. It's only a personal thing for this particular, it's an Atwa trip that I'm on. And then whatever you do with the rest of it, I guess it's up to you. But it makes no difference now that 20 years have gone by. If I'm guilty or not guilty is really immaterial. It doesn't really hold any balance to any particular reality that has anything to do with anything. Pushing blame in circles and play acting punishing someone else because you're not sure of something is really rather primitive. This day and age, the technology that we have, I want to say this to all of you. This is important to your life. When a holy war is called upon the planet Earth by holy man, that there is a word that we use, God, that holds all the other words together. This holy war invokes all uniformed personnel into procedure. All uniformed personnel pick up authority as if we are in a war, a struggle with the enemy, and the fight is to the death. There is no slack in the act. There is no in between. There is no way you can cut it any different. You will fight or you will die. You will fight the enemy or you will be executed. He stood up against the wall and shot, because it's simple. When your enemy comes to you, he's coming to you to kill you. He's not coming to you to play video games. You're stuck off in video games. You're stuck off in technology. You think you're protected by your big government, but you're not. Your government can sell you out just as quick as Nixon did. And so did Bush, because Bush's mind is stuck off in the war of 1812 somewhere, man. He doesn't even have any idea where his mind is. He thinks the Japanese just bombed Pearl Harbor. I thought they bombed them all. But, you know, it's kind of silly, isn't it? That this comes into play, that you got to know this. And this is the only thing I've said to you that you made you, that's made you all mad at me. Your enemy. You got to know your enemy. You know who your enemy is? You're the enemy out there. You're the enemy. You sit there fat, sloppy, you watch your TV, you kick back and you judge everybody as being wrong and bad, but you. It's not that way at all. It doesn't roll that way. You can blame me all day long, and it's not going to change the fact. Your atmosphere is dying. Your polar caps are melting. Your ozones are falling. The air that's touching your icebergs now is the air we put out in the 50s. By the time you get to the 60s and 70s, we are landing a new ship. A new millennium, Captain Quadro, C4, is at war's door right now. The door opens. It's all at war against you. You say, we the people versus the United States of America. It's the same when you said, we the people versus Manson, because I was Nixon's divorce court. On the Ho Min Shin Trail, on the Denver computer. That's my ghost. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you.